have a studio in Holland and a collection. I studied in Holland and I studied in England. I graduated from the Royal College of Art and then I worked a couple of years for Habitat in London. Went back to Holland and because the climate in Holland had completely changed when I came back in the middle of the end of the 90s. We had an organization called Droog Design in Holland, which you might know, and otherwise you should look it up. And it was a completely different field in design. I'm here today also to speak a bit about Dutch design in general, not only about my own work. I will tiptoe through a few issues. When I started really as a designer, Mie was saying that we get lots of education in how you start up a business. Well, I did not. Not at all. I had to do it all completely from scrap. And the first thing I did was showing my own collections, making pieces of furniture and showing it in Milan or in London in exhibitions. Or I rented them scruffy places. But after a while, I was asked also by companies, and at the moment we have two parts in my company. One is the collection that we still sell internationally, and for the other part is the studio, and with that we work for international clients like Magis, Capellini, Itala, Scandinavian companies, Italian companies, and we work on interiors and exhibitions and architectural projects. Right, I'm going to take you through a couple of things. Where is the pointer? Here, left it. I'm going to talk about Korea and the Netherlands, why Dutch design came up a bit. I will talk a bit about that, the Dutch borders, and some cases about me. Dutch design now today, some strengths and weaknesses, interesting for Korea, because that's what we hear about, aren't we? And future issues. First of all, if you didn't know yet, here's your country, we are there, and we are super small. And I did some research into you, so I get a little introduction into your country and you about me, our country. You have a mountain, Paek Tue Sam, who is the biggest one in, I believe, in this country. It's 2,744 meters. Our highest mountain is 300 meters high. It's below. You know, there's a building that's almost that tall. I have investigated a bit into your country and I found out that you have kimchi, you have carrots and all kind of, you do with vegetables, you make your kimchi. We make with this almost the same ingredients, we eat hotspot all the day and it's almost like a kind of one pot food. But, you know, in the end I think it looks very similar. And then I looked up some very famous Dutch people that you might know in Korea. One was Hendrik Hamel, who is supposed to be some kind of, I don't know if you know about him. In Holland they say that everyone in Korea knows about him. He was a shipwreck person. He arrived here in 1600 blah blah, and he was for a long time a person that told the world about Korea, and he was a way to make the people in Europe aware of Korea. And then on the right, one of our most famous football trainers, Guus Hiddink, which you might know of more recent years, and he's at least a very famous Dutch person for you maybe. The only thing I wanted to say, and which I thought might be interesting in this perspective as well, that he's from a little village. And it's actually the same village that I grew up in. And when I was a little girl, 15 years old, I was delivering newspapers in my village and I had to deliver a newspaper to this guy every morning. Anyway, let's go to the early 90s. When I started and when I got from my art school, these were the classics in Holland. There was this guy, you see him at the right, he's still alive, he's 90 now. You know, the classics in Holland were a kind of furniture that was all came out of industrial thinking. In a way, we had, of course, as everywhere in Europe, had a kind of industrial revolution. And in the 50s, 60s, we still had that kind of stuff. And people were, the designers in that age were thinking from, you know, making efficient production, thinking industrial. In a way, you could say how to move from craft to industry, folding metal and make it strong, making the legs were of these chairs, it was, you know, doing it with industrial techniques and trying to make it in such a way that you can do it more efficient, quicker, and so on. This is a chair, Revolt, out of 1953, and it's an extremely well-known chair in Holland. I think almost everyone in Holland has been sitting on this, and it's really a kind of classic. There are clever solutions and so on. But it's all also, you have to put it in a perspective of making products in the, you know, in the industrial time that was there at that time. It's completely different than now. And this was also a very classic. Every, you know, the people in Holland, the designers, they looked from, they were very practical, efficient, right? This is actually a sofa that you can fold out and make a bed. You know, we didn't have a lot of space. We were very practical. If you have a guest over, for your house to visit, let's do it with this kind of thing. The focus was on functionality, efficiency, and lasting for a lifetime. I think that's also very nice. They didn't think it was kind of a natural thing to have something for a long time. The thing about it is that by producing and by focusing on industry, in a way, crafts got lost. We forgot about how to make our classic wooden shoes. I didn't show you yet, but in Holland we did have that, and we still have some, but we forgot about it. It's very difficult. Basket weaving, it's hardly anyone in Holland who still can do it. Painting ceramics, we had a very famous a company called Royal Tichelaar that has decided to stop painting hands only on when people are asking really for it, but they have no regular painting anymore because it's hard, it's impossible to pay for it. People, you know, with going into these industrial processes, everything is more efficient but also price efficient, and that means that some things get lost. Here I see my, you know, even making clothes. There's hardly anyone anymore who makes his own clothes. When I grew up, my mother, my grandmother, everyone was making their own clothes. I have to admit that I never managed to get further than knitting a sock this far because the heel was so difficult to me and I stopped. But my mother, she can still do it. And all this kind of stuff is also important for you know, when you are designing, when you're trying to make objects. So, this was the situation in the 90s. We had, when I started, actually there was no work for designers like me. I came out of a school, I was trained with my own ideas about design. All the companies who had designers, they were in-house designers, and the company situations were completely blocked. You could say, you could try to go to a furniture company and ask for, you know, to do some work, but they would say, yeah, sorry, we have already an in-house designer, it's fine, we don't need anyone. The industry was not really within reach, because if you want to do it, you have to invest, and especially if you come from art school, you don't have investing, you don't have a lot of money to invest, and there's no banks who want to help you at all. So the young designers of that age, they of my time, we were interested in exploring the world and doing other things. We wanted to use other materials and techniques. We were bored with minimalism. You know, I look at it now as fantastic stuff, but at that time I thought, oh, this is so boring. And we were craving for experiment and expression in things. And we were so fed up with all this rationalizing in a way as well. We were really looking for, you know, getting out of the restrictions of the time, of the restrictions of industry in a way as well. We were looking for the irrational and the unexpected. So what you get, what you saw is that in the beginning of the 90s, experiment and expression came up, and you got things, I think you might know about them if you looked into digital design a bit, but there's these pieces from Pita and Eek who started to work with scrap material, which was within reach. A guy like Teo Rimi made this very famous chair with his milk bottle light. He worked with a lamp. He worked with the materials which were around him in his area. And then there's a very famous chair which came out a bit later by Marcel Landers, which was really also exploring new techniques, working with the new materials and trying to out some new visuals of chairs and furniture. And in a way, also, you know, also I was in the middle of this time. It wasn't really like, oh, let's do something completely different. It really was a result of exploring and playing, and then it wasn't like a business plan or whatsoever. There were also others who were looking more into trying to deal with these crafts that were disappearing, playing with handmade and with these visuals of looking handmade and using the handmade techniques. Like here, this, all this, in a way, the materials are inlaid wood. Also, the functionality was thrown out of the window in a way. You know, of course, these pieces can work. This is a bathtub made out of a boat. At the same time, it's also playing a game with what you know about bathtub, boat, blah, 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 blah. The main thing wasn't always on a clear, clean-cut functionality like the guys that I was pointing out earlier. And the expression of things was kind of nice. This is painting, making completely new ways of decorated, painted ceramics. And there was a group of people, I think it wasn't really a group of people that did that everyone was, it was a bit of a hybrid culture. Everyone was going into all kinds of directions. And one of the directions I also think was going on was that people were looking into the gaps of industry. How can you, or looking at new techniques, here I show some pictures of myself, but I try to explain as well. There's this tree, which is, you know, now is completely old-fashioned, but at that time it was very modern. I used a laser cutter, and by cutting out a tree and by folding the sheets very easily, I made this coat stand. And here I made a chair that has, this piece and these pieces. At the back here, they fit it, this piece fits between the legs, and that piece and these two curly bits, they fit here, and they fit between another leg. And it was also about making when you're flat, it fits all between the legs, and then it becomes a kind of very efficient flat pack cut out on a chair, on a sheet of wood. So in a way, it was about efficiency. Also, but at the way it looked, it is a chair that is has all these little patterns in it. What you do when you are a little kid, you fold paper, cut out patterns, and you get a funny, very funny tablecloth. With the laser cutter, you could follow your scissors and have the wobbliness in the material. So in one hand, this was producing a kind of chair that looks almost like a craft made chair that people were chiseling out the holes for a long time. In the same, but it is actually a chair that you can cut out at 12 in the morning, and then you have chairs. This is the same story. It looks maybe very artificial, but at the same time, it was a story about thinking about the industry. When you make service sets, you make a lot of you have to make for soup tureens. You have a soup tureen, you have a container, a lid, handles, and so on. You have lots of different molds, and then you have the sugar pot and the milk can, and so on. And you have a lot, end up with lots of different molds. I try to look at how to make with just a few molds, make a lot of different objects. So you have here, you have a small tube, a bigger tube, a tube that's in the middle, a plunger, and a corner. And with these five elements, you can play like a ceramic Lego and build all kinds of objects. Here, this guy Bertel Pot, he made a light, which is also playing with how in industry wool is made to balls, and using that for a light. You know, it's kind of looking how can we manipulate the industry, and that is what we were interested in. Right. I would like to talk about a few cases to give you a kind of idea about what happened in Dutch design. This is one case of a company that was set up in 2003. This is actually a company which was called the Koninklijke Van Kempen in Beheer, and they were a company since 1789. They had, at that time, they had three brands. One was BK, and they did pots and pans. And these are the pots and pans that everyone in Holland, my mother, also Puus Hiddink's mother, she was cooking hutspot in this, you know? That's what we do in Holland. Then we had they had a brand called Gero, and they made everyday life, daily life tableware, cutlery sets. And then there was a company called Keltem, which was the oldest one, and it was the art of dyeing since 1789. They are silverware, chicer, much chicer than that. Anyway, they had three brands and they wanted to set up something new. They realized that today's people don't buy complete cassettes of cutlery anymore. And they wanted to work with the Dutch designers that had came up in that time. They had already made connections with some people. They wanted to make a complete new brand that was not so locally organized anymore, because usually these brands are very organized towards countries, but they wanted to cross the borders. And they connected with some designers, gave the marketing people a mission to come up with a theme. And then the marketing people looked at it and they said, well, we have already three brands, we think we don't need anything anymore. And I was already more or less involved in this, and I thought, hey, this is interesting. I have never heard marketing people saying, we don't need anything anymore. They usually come up with something. So in my opinion, that was a very new thing. And they had to do their homework again. And they came back with the story and they said, okay, if we set up a new brand that is contemporary and looking into the design, the needs of people today, we have to look at smart essentials, objects that we really need and that don't end up in your kitchen drawer for, you know, that you use on a usual basis, and something that are really clever. So they had a word that had to deal with it, and it's called smart essentials. So they gave the designers that had to deal with this new brand that was positioned more over the international than just in Holland itself, had to deal with that. And for me, this has been always a fantastic thing to have in the back of my mind. Although these guys like Friso Kramer and Mr. Visser, that I showed in the beginning, were also these kind of very clear, clean, smart, essential people in a way. I was getting also more interested in this. Anyway, what I did for these guys a garlic press. I'm a really bad cook. I cannot make hutspot. I have to do the dishes at home, and my boyfriend cooks. So when I open the dishwasher, there's always, if you have a garlic press, there's all this shit in the garlic press. So I wanted to make something that was easy to clean. There's this object, it's this small. You press the garlic, you roll it, and you wash it under the kitchen, under the water, and by rinsing it, it's clean. But also, it's made from a metal that takes away the smell of garlic. So your hands don't smell of garlic. And it's very easy to clean. We made things like that for the habits of people today. People are now not eating anymore as 50 years ago. They were all eating at the same table with the whole family. Nowadays, people, although we like it or not, they sometimes eat alone in front of the television. And for that kind of habits, you can use these kind of bowls and sit, move around in your room. We made a nutcracker with the big, the lid can be used two ways up. So in this way you can crack big nuts, and with this thing down you can do small nuts, and then you all your pieces don't crack everywhere. It's very practical, and I love to do it. It's a bit of like being a small inventor. There's also other people who are involved in this. Maybe you've seen this. This is fantastic. It's for the same company, Rogue VKB. He made this guy, Jorre van Ast, he made these lids, and he discovered that everywhere there are only five screw types on jam jars and so on. And for these five types, he made these lids. So you only buy the lids, and if you want to throw away your jam jars, you can put it under there, and then you make your own little sets with it. And I think it's a very interesting move that a commercial company is taking in the fact that people throw things away and that you produce only half the part of it. I think this is a good thing to keep in mind. It's good moves to deal with. This Royal Vicar Bay, they got a lot of prizes and awards, and somehow they became the most fantastic company, and they had a big award. They were the best commissioner in Holland in the year 2010, and it worked out really like a very well worked out. It was very, they are regarded as a very interesting company in Holland today. Also because they care about nowadays, with the new materials of today, with the ways we live today, how we are not moving on with the same tradition that we always had, but dealing with what's going really in this time going on. Then a second quick case. This is about Royal Arend. Royal Arend is an old company, and that's, I think, is maybe interesting. I don't know if you have a lot of super old industries in Holland, in Korea, but I think it is also something that is maybe a problem when industries are getting older. They have done so many things that they are losing their identity, and they are maybe finding their, you know, it's getting more difficult to find out what you are about or to stick with your basic stuff. This is an example of a company that has been a bit older. It's set up by this Mr. Arend. He had a kind of a company that was more selling stuff. He connected with two production companies in Holland, in Sint-Oederode and in Zwanenburg. This company, and I put in a picture for Frans, because that company was set up by this man here, and he's your grandfather, isn't he? It's his uncle. It's the uncle of Frans, guys. When Frans is on stage, you can check if he looks like him. Anyway, this company, they had, in Holland, they made a lot. They made basically for all of Holland all the office furniture in the 50s, 60s, blah, blah, blah. They were very highly regarded, and they still are. They were efficient, they were looking at these kind of clever techniques, very simple ways of dealing with it. But at the same time, I had at one point a conversation with the director of that company, and I was just going there for tea and not even thinking of getting a commission, just having a nice conversation. But when we were talking, I said to him, well, you know, one of the problems I have with you now is that for me, it is not clear what your identity is. You produce these kind of chairs at the moment, but they are exactly the same as any of your other competitors. And I don't want to tell you that you have to do completely weird things and that you have to go off your trolley, but it is important that you know where your roots are and that you stick to somehow to what the idea that people have in your mind about you. This is the first chair that I showed. This guy who is now 90, this is this icon of Holland. And somehow, if you ask people about what did Arend do in the past, they will always go back to that chair. And I don't say that you have to make that kind of chairs all the time. But there is a kind of, there's more to it than just rational foundations. It's not only about, okay, does it sit well? Does it do this? Does it do that? Does it do that? Is it practical? Blah, blah, blah. There's also something like an icon or something like a kind of communal memory that people have in the back of their mind about what is this company standing for. Okay, well, although I was there just for a cup of tea, he said, well, if you have so many comments, madame, you make the next chair for us. So I was getting a bit nervous then, but one of the things that I talked about was you know, when they were doing these fantastic things in the 50s, 40s, and 60s, what they were doing also was looking, and I keep hammering on this this afternoon, looking at the materials and the techniques of that time. And so one of the things I wanted to do with the new chair that I did for them was looking at the new materials and techniques of this time. We're living in 2014 nowadays, and for me it doesn't make any sense to make a chair that we could also do 20 years ago. It's a complete nonsense. We have already enough stuff, so if I add a chair, it has to be, it has to make some sense for me. We looked into this company, Arendt, was highly interested in cradle to cradle and into ecological problems. So we looked at the materials that are now ecologically okay. And we looked at this chair is completely out of recycled materials and it's also recyclable. We had to look for, this is something in the process. You see it's still very hands-on and very, not very high tech at all, but it needs to happen, and I believe that by doing it this way you can also, you know, you can react much quicker on where things have to go. The thing was, we had to look for some materials that were very strong to sit on and being recycled, and something that was very flexible. I made a very flexible back for the chair, and with that flexibility, you can make sure that fat people, high people, tall people, small people, that they give a lot of, there is more comfort for more types of people. Anyway, this is the chair, and a couple of things that we looked into is that, you know, this back is very flexible. You can put it on the, but you can also take it off and make it put, and transport it like that. It means that you are only transporting half a parcel around the world, which is nice. There's a flexible back. It's made out of PET, old Coca-Cola bottles. One of the things is that it's very important that for recycling, that if you have two different materials, that you can screw it out of each other in 30 seconds, so you can recycle it very quick. The chair can be stacked, you can have arms, there is so much nice things to this chair, blah, blah, blah. But what I'm most of it proud of is that it's a chair that radiates what I am about and what the company is about, and that it looks again like an icon that could be, that which is in this communal memory of people when they are thinking about the company Arendt. And Arendt, they got suddenly so many prizes that year when they brought out the chair. So this sounds a bit silly. If you hire me, you get a lot of prizes, but that's a bit stupid. But suddenly they were, they thought they got a good design prize, blah, 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 blah. But they were very proud. They thought, hey, God, you know, maybe she's right. She's not too bad. But, okay. And now something for something completely different. I showed you two very industrial projects, but we do also completely different projects. This is a project I did finished last year, and it's dealing with these local crafts. It's a very special story, I have to tell you a bit about it. It's an island called Fogo. It's a very isolated island between Newfoundland, Canada, and Greenland. This island used to be an island where everyone was fishing. Until the 60s, everyone in this island, all the boys, went to school till they were 9. And then they had to help their fathers in the ice-cold sea to get fishing, and they had to go there from 4 o'clock in the morning till 11 in the night, and it's super cold over there. One of the fishermen, the fish was always bought by the fishing corporations, and they kept the fishermen very poor. One of the fishermen had, this sounds like a fairy tale, had 6 sons and 1 daughter. And he thought, I want to have my daughter to study, and he managed to get her on the University of Ottawa. She set up a business in fiber optics, sold her company, and became one of the richest women in Canada. And with this money, she started to do projects on illiteracy in Africa and on alphabetism. And then after a while, she thought, hang on, I come from this island, and all my friends that studied with me, or that I went to school with, the boys, only went to school till they were nine. And there's also a problem there, because my island, people are leaving it. It's a rural community. People are, there's no work. It's hard to stay there alive. The younger people are leaving. They're going to work on the drilling platforms in Canada. And she wanted to do something back for the island. She set up a foundation, and with this foundation, the first thing she did was setting up some artist residencies, some beautiful little studios where, if you are from Korea, you can also apply to go there and work there for a bit. But also I, as a Dutch person or whatever. And from that idea, working together with this architect, I will show you some of these little studios later on, working with these architects, they set up an idea to make an inn, a hotel. She calls it an inn. And for that, she asked designers to do the furniture. And they asked me to do furniture for the inn, working with the people from the island. So it was not produced in a high-tech factory, but I had to work with the people who were working on this island. I'll show you. This is some pictures of Fogo Island. Completely frozen sea, lobster nets, a lot of snow and ice. Very beautiful island. Although it's super cold, I was there in February, they sell ice cold beer, yeah? Which is never bad. If you like beer, I don't like beer actually. And these are some of these studios that they set up. It's very, very beautiful. The idea is that people can work in these studios, but they live in the villages with the people. And this is the inn that they built. When they started the project, the island has 2,000 people, and there's 7 villages. Every village has 2 churches, a Catholic church, a Protestant church, because the people who live there have Irish ancestors. And in Europe, it's very well known that the Irish have a problem with the Catholics and the Protestants. Anyway, they're not so religious anymore, so this church was closed down, and they use it as the workshop to make all the furniture. These are the men I had to work with. They used to be fishermen. They worked on boats, and in the winter they would produce some furniture. But they never learned that as a profession. They learned it from their fathers. They never learned to read a drawing. So I had to explain to them how to make things by doing it myself. This guy here is very special, because this guy is called Walter. He was completely depressed. I met his wife, and he was working on this project for a couple for the inn and for the little artist residencies. And his wife said, "I suddenly have another man in my house. There is a perspective. This man is working now on something on the island. It's getting very attracting tourists. They're now, it's getting very successful. People are coming to the island to have a kind of geo-tourism. It's a National Geographic kind of place that looks nice. But this man, he suddenly thinks, you know, there's something nice happening on my island." He was really very, very depressed in the last few years. And helping to make this island better made for him a big difference. These were the women. The women were doing a lot of quilting and handworking on the island. And this was the kind of typical furniture that I saw on the island when I arrived there. Very chunky, crafty looking, very fat legs, and a lot of these types of chairs. And from that, we decided to make 4 chairs, types of chairs for the inn. And I decided to make very chunky. I looked at the workshops that they had and the kind of work that they could do, I made very chunky spinning work, and this was all halved in pieces. I told the guys, because these guys that I had to work with, they are anarchists. They were the boss on the boat. They didn't want to listen to a woman or to anyone, in fact. So I thought, I said to them, okay, here, there and there, we need to know, we fix the size, and in between you can do it yourself. So I gave them the option to do something themselves and make these chairs part of their own. Funny thing is that they found out about a copy spinning machine and they loved that and everything became the same. Anyway, here you can see some of the process. I really had to talk them through it. Completely different than industrial design, as you can see. This is another guy, Dan, completely proud of what he did. And on this island they have very, very particular colors. It's all like kind of greenish, bluish icebergs almost. And these kind of colors, these very typical, almost very weak pinks and so on, we used for the furniture. Sometimes also tough. And here we are, some weak pinks. And that's how they end up in the rooms, in the lobbies, and so on. We did another project also for this island, which was for the terrace. This worked out very well. They asked if I could do also something for the outside. And then because there was much less time for that, we kept it very simple and made some planky furniture. And very much based also on these plank. This is actually super nice birdhouse. They make it themselves. I like it when people design themselves and there's no designer. Anyway, these planky things we used for as an inspiration for the plank furniture that got out there for the terraces. And these guys, they really got the hold of making production in their little workshops. And then the last little project for this island, because you find everywhere, you find these funny wood constructions. We made furniture for the island too in the public spaces, very simple fences. And you can sit there when you're hiking on the island, you can sit there. Okay, let's go to some other Dutch designers, because I'm not here only for myself. I think what's interesting, and that's why I was showing also this project on Faroe Islands, is that design is not only anymore about hardcore production or thinking about production techniques and making objects. Design is nowadays also dealing with social issues and how to improve people's life in a way. And I think that's you know, one of the things that just crossed my mind now is that when I was in England once, I went to a factory where they were producing metal cupboards, and there was a guy standing to a pile of metal sheets, 1 millimeter thin, so it was a very big pile, and he had to put these sheets into the machine all the time. And I thought, when I saw that, I thought, as a designer, although it's not happening like that so much anymore, I am responsible for a person's luck, what he has to do every day. So, you know, there's a lot of people nowadays who say, I want to have an office job, I don't want to do shice jobs in a factory anymore. But we as designers should be aware of what we ask people to do if they work in factories. Anyway, I'm very keen on this stuff, that you have to work with the materials and techniques and the social habits of this time. Otherwise, I think design makes no sense. And also, the Dutch designers are very strong somehow in, if you cannot do it with an industry, they do it themselves. An example of a Dutch designer who is dealing with these social issues is this guy. He's called Tjeerd Veenhoven. He has... He looked into this world of, you probably know these rubber flip-flops that you have on your feet in the summer. And apparently, because they are the cheapest shoes in the world, also the poorest people in the world buy them, but they end up a lot in the seas. And the shoes from India, they end up at the seashore of Mozambique. And it's a plastic soup that is going through the world, and it's really making, polluting our world. He found out a way this is an example of how you deal with a port, but this is how you could deal with a slipper. He found out that palm leaves, which are from palm trees, to deal with it in a biological way, you can make leather out of it. And from that, he has now set up slippers that he is with Reebok, setting up a company in India, and they are selling slippers for less than a dollar. Trying to get people, give people cheap shoes, but they are not messing up our world in such a way. I think it's a very good example of a designer that tries to do to get his feet in the door. If the companies don't do it, he will do it and try to set it up. There's also, in Holland, you still see a lot of people who are doing research and development themselves, or they start to produce things themselves. I still have a big workshop next to my studio where we have woodwork and welding and so on. But maybe you've seen this in the past. This is a guy called Dirk van der Kooi. He bought a robot in China and uses this as a big 3D printer where he uses the granules from old refrigerators to make chairs. These chairs, they are on the side here, as you can see, and then this chair, this robot prints out a whole chair. He completely did this himself. He set up this company himself and he sells these chairs. And this is a girl, Marianne van Abel. She is experimenting with wood and injecting it with biological resins to foam it up and make interesting new materials. I think that's very valuable, and it's also something that's very much happening in Holland, this kind of approach of do-it-yourself. And a very, maybe very famous guy that you might know as well is this guy from Holland called Marcel Wanders. He is maybe a very good example of also how Dutch designers, if the industry is not helping them themselves, they are doing it themselves, and they do also the sales and marketing themselves. I think that's a very Dutch approach to do. If someone is not doing it for you, do it yourself. And some are very successful. Here is some exhibition that Marcel Wanders had last year in Milan, which was very, very beautiful, I have to say. Anyway, he has grown out to one. He's actually now the biggest design company in Holland, maybe after Neolux, I don't know. But in each case, there's a serious guy, and it all came from a designer. Okay, so the Dutch Beyond Borders, I have to look and not triple over what I wrote myself, but it's a very much a do-it-yourself mentality. We are, I think, in Holland very good in questioning, experimental, and we are educated also being experimental. This is also a downside, maybe, because we are so into experimenting that we hardly forget, that we sometimes forget to be realistic. I have to say that that's maybe a dangerous thing. Anyway, what did I write there? The type of work is rather exclusive. Well, you know, because the way we started to question a lot of things, we end up also with very exclusive types of work, which I think what is very dangerous at the moment in Holland is that we are so into conceptual design that we forget about how to deal with production. And I think that is a serious question to ask, also because the big mass-produced world is, the world of mass production is a serious world that is having a bigger, much bigger effect on how our Earth is on the heritage of the world than when we do the smaller scale productions. And I think the designers have to deal with this because we're also responsible for that. Blah, 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 blah. Oh yeah, why did we get over the borders? I work a lot in other countries, but a lot of Dutch designers do that. It's because our industry is almost diminished, is almost gone. It's also because we are a small country and we have to go somewhere else because there's not enough place. But maybe also if we are into this very some of the work is less democratic or more exclusive, then you have to go to other borders as well. And our crafts are gone, which is a problem. Now looking at Korea again. I just picked up a couple of things. I don't know if you are familiar with this, but this is what comes out in Holland as Korean design, which is interesting to you maybe to know that we look at it as design. Of course, we also know about Samsung and LG and blah blah blah. But if I go into magazines, I see this as Korean design. And when I look at it, I think, yeah, God, we are in such a global world nowadays. It looks nice, I have to say, compliments for you. But at the same time, it feels also a bit as if it's so global, as every shopping street in the world has an H&M. This is how design looks nowadays. It looks like, this is design. It's almost like a sticker. This is design. I think Korea and the Netherlands, I've talked actually now a lot about objects, furniture, and so on. But apart from looking at production and mass production and smaller craft production, and has to be clear is that we have to deal not only with industry, but also with social problems and with the world's with the problems of today's world. And there are a lot. And I think what is really a problem is that we have to tackle as designers, 5 minutes, I manage that, don't worry. One of the problems we really need to deal with is the waste in the world. And that's why I really like this project of the slippers, and that is in a small way trying to deal with this plastic soup. I have to look this up, or I wrote it down, because what's going on with these televisions? What did I write? Yeah, there are 100,000 televisions thrown away every two days. Isn't that ridiculous? I think it is. At the same time, we throw away a lot of food. There's a big problem everywhere in the world, and especially in the developing countries, is urbanism. People are leaving the countrysides and going to cities. This means that we have a lot of different ways to deal with transport. I think that, we had a discussion about that last night, but I think cars are going to be completely out of fashion. For a lot of people it's still a status symbol, but it's much more efficient to go with public transport than with cars if you are in cities. Also in cities, people are, if you go on your tube in Korea, Seoul also, you will see that everyone is on his laptop and so on and so on. And that is possible in a tube and in a train and not in a car, because you have to hold your steering wheel. So a lot of things are going to happen there. But also because of this urbanization here, we have a problem that everyone on the countryside who can produce our food is going to disappear. And that will have a big effect on food. So here we throw food away, here we have a food problem, and then we have an aging population, which is also a big problem that's coming and heading us for the future. Also the aging populations on the countryside, the area where we have to produce our food. There's a lot of issues I think that we have to deal with in the future, but I think the food is definitely going to be a big problem that we really need to tackle. And maybe it's ambitious, we can also work with Samsung or with Philips, but I think the Dutch designers and Korea designers, but actually designers all over the world, have to be helping also out on this food problem. And then I get back to where I was starting from. Somehow, you know, to deal with these things, we have to ask the questions and be critical and ask about, can we not do it the other way around? Just like we asked for the, when we are looking at factories as designers, can't we do it in another way? Can't we fill the gaps in the situation? Here we also have to work and ask the right questions and take initiative. We have to mix high tech and low tech. We have to mix industry and craft. Make sure the things that are still there are not getting lost. And use design thinking. I think it's very—it's not to promote designers in a way, but I think really that designers can make a difference in dealing with problems and to deal with social issues as well. And let's start with Korea and the Netherlands. But I really think for a lot of the problems that are going to head us for the future, we need to have international cooperation. I know actually that at this very moment there is a big. This is also serious stuff, but there's a big international convention going on in Holland about security, the nuclear top, which you had 2 years ago, which is also interesting actually. But to deal with it, I thought, okay, if we already have almost similar food, maybe we can also start to work on the conversations for this. Thank you very much.